morning and welcome to Grace. We're so excited that you joined us today. If you're a first-time guest, please fill out a connections card, drop it off at the connections desk. We have a gift just for you. Here's what's going on at Grace.
Legacy's Christmas party is going to be held on December 4th at 5 o'clock at the home of Larry and Betty Parker. If you need more information, stop by the Connection Center. December 18th at 6 p.m. in the sanctuary, the music team is going to be hosting a special time of worship, telling the story of Jesus through scripture and song. There's going to be hymns, carols, vocal solos, a brass ensemble. This is going to be a great time. You don't want to miss it. Again, in the sanctuary, December 18th at 6 p.m. Legacy will be going to see the movie I Heard the Bells on Friday, December 2nd. This movie tells the inspiring story of a beloved Christmas carol and the author, Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. If you need more information, stop by the Connection Center.
Ladies, it's time to deck the church. We're going to be decorating for Christmas. November 27th at 2, we'll be unpacking and setting up. And on November 29th at 6 p.m., we'll actually be decorating. That way, maybe there's a chance you can come to one or both. Anyway it goes, we're going to have fun doing it. We hope to see you there.
On December 11th in the morning service, Grace Kids is going to be presenting Hotel Noel, a Christmas musical. Please make sure you're making plans to attend. I promise it's going to be a good time. Invite your friends, your family, and let's come out and support Grace Kids and the Grace Kids team ministry.
Grace Ladies Christmas Fellowship will be December 6th at 6 p.m. at the home of Sandy Riley. We are asking you to bring a soup, a side, or a dessert and a friend. You're guaranteed to have a great time. If you need directions, they're at the Connection Center.
Everyone ages 18 to 25 is invited to the College and Career Class Christmas Party. It'll be held at the home of Megan and Skylar Smith in Marianna on December 16th at 5 o'clock. You're asked to bring soup, side, or a dessert, and a pair of crazy Christmas socks to exchange. If you need directions or an address, stop by the Connections desk and they'll give it to you.
There we go. Good morning. It's nice I can control stuff from this right here, but when you don't know what you're doing, it doesn't make much of a difference. It's good to see you in the house of the Lord this morning. Isn't it good to be in God's house? Amen. Aren't you glad to be here? I always heard an old preacher say I'd rather be here than the finest hospital in the land. Amen. It's good to be in God's house. Today, we're going to kick things off with our scripture reading. So if you will stand with us all over the house, we're going to read a passage of scripture from the book of Isaiah, chapter number 11, and we're going to read aloud together beginning in verse 1. We're going to read verses 1 through 10. So let's read God's word together. Here we go. And there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord, and shall make him of quick understanding in the fear of the Lord. And he shall not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove after the hearing of his ears. But with righteousness shall he judge the poor, and reprove with equity for the meek of the earth. And he shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips shall he slay the wicked. And righteousness shall be the girdle of his loins, and faithfulness the girdle of his reins. The wolf also shall dwell with the lamb, and the leopard shall lie down with the kid, and the calf, and the young lion, and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. And the cow and the bear shall feed, their young ones shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like an ox. And the sucking child shall play on the hole of the asp, and the weaned child shall put his hand on the cockatrice's den. They shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountain. For the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea. And in that day there shall be a root of Jesse, which shall stand for an ensign of the people. To it shall the Gentiles seek, and his rest shall be glorious. Somebody say, thank you, Jesus. Amen. Have a seat for just a moment this morning as we're going to kick off worship a little bit differently this morning. Today starts off a season in the Christian year called Advent. Now, Advent means arrival, right? Advent means arrival. Now, we're getting ready to celebrate the first Advent of Jesus, right? The first coming of the Lord. But how many of you are looking forward to that great second Advent, the second coming of Jesus? Aren't we excited? And don't we have a blessed hope today, knowing that we look for a Savior that is to come? We have a promise. We know that because He came once, we know that He'll come again. Amen? Isn't that something to look forward to? Amen. We're going to celebrate the season of Advent this morning and talk about that blessed hope. So the idea of Advent, as you remember from last year, the idea is that as we look back at the first coming of Christ and celebrate this season, we look forward to the second coming of Christ with great hope. Amen. And so Brother Rick and Sister Karen are coming this morning and going to lead us in our Advent lesson for this morning, that dealing with hope. Brother Rick, Sister Karen.
Good morning. The prophets of the Old Testament wrote longingly of their love for a Messiah. The law of God demanded a sacrifice for sin, but no sacrifice they could bring to the temple could eliminate their sin for them. However, God gave the prophets the promises of one who would fulfill the law and eradicate their sins. Jeremiah prophesied, "Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, that I will perform that good thing which I have promised to the house of Israel and to the house of Judah." Isaiah proclaimed the promise of a Savior when he said, "Therefore the Lord himself will guide you with a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel." The prophet Micah further declared this hope when he prophesied, "But you, Bethlehem Ephratah, though you are little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of you shall come forth of me the one who will rule in Israel, whose goings forth from the days of old, from everlasting, Jesus, the Son of God, left his eternal place in heaven and came to earth in the lowly form of man and gave his life as the supreme sacrifice for sin in order to fulfill the law. The hope of Israel had finally arrived." However, hope didn't end there. Ever since he rose from the grave and ascended into heaven, we in the church have been eagerly awaiting his promised second coming. Amen. Amen?
Yes.
This reminds us, for the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in the present age, looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So we light this first candle on the wreath, which serves us as a reminder of this blessed hope that we have. The first time he came to earth, it was humbly in the form of a child placed in a manger. The second time he comes, he will come with all power, might, and glory.
Amen.
This is our blessed hope.
Amen.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this season because it reminds us, love, of the love that you have for us, Lord. We thank you, Lord, because it reminds us that you have a plan for us, Lord, a plan,
yes,
hope, and a future. And Lord, I pray right now as we go out and go through this busy season, Lord, that you will just help us not to forget that we have the hope that the world needs. We thank you for that, Lord. Amen.
Amen. Would you stand with us all over the house this morning as we worship God and thank him for that blessed hope? Hallelujah. To you, O Lord, I lift my soul. In you, O God, I place my trust. Do not let me be put to shame. hands this morning.
Oh, you called me from the grave by name. You called me out of all my shame. I see the old has passed away. The Spirit lives in me. Oh, I see my past has been redeemed and the new has come. Now I have resurrection power living on the inside, Jesus. You have given us freedom. No longer bound by sin and darkness. Sing that.
again. Oh, when we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we know less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun.
You ought to lift your hands and praise Him today.
Oh, praise God.
Sing the first verse one more time.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind.
Because of the grace of God. Give Him glory and honor in His house. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Lord. Aren't you thankful for the grace of God? Aren't you thankful to be born again? Come on, somebody, and give Him glory. Give Him honor. Oh, hallelujah. How many of you, He brought you through something? You ought to praise Him for it if He brought you through. Amen. How many of you, He brought you out of darkness into His marvelous light? You ought to praise Him if He saved you this morning. Hallelujah. Oh, through many dangers, tolls, and snares, I have already come. Oh, tis grace, the precious grace of God, me saved thus far, and grace will lead me home.
And
when we get home, when we've
been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we know less days to sing God's praise than
praise this morning. Hallelujah. Oh, yes. Amen. Remain standing with us this morning as we go to the Lord in prayer.
I once was lost, but now I'm found. Is that your testimony today?
Amen.
Good, good God. Grace kids can be dismissed. Go do awesome things. That is a great group of kids. Look at that going out there. And teachers and instructors, thank God for teachers that get a burden for children on their hearts to share the love of Christ. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer right now. First of all, can I see your hand if the Lord has ever answered a prayer for you? If He's ever heard you? If you've ever brought a need before Him that only He could answer, and you heard from Him. All right. Now raise your hand today if you've got a need today. You need to hear from God in this place. You've got a lost loved one. You've got a situation in your family. You've got a sickness. He is able. We want to lift up a two-month-old baby we just learned about this morning. Blaze Henderson is in the hospital, 2 months old, with RSV. So having respiratory issues, we're going to ask God to undertake for Blaze this morning. Going to continue to pray for John Watson for strength in his recovery. Continuing to pray for the Springer family as they are just in a trying spot right now. Let's just continue to pray for them. Let's continue to pray for the Milton family. This is a 17-month-old with cancerous tumors in her brain. Two of them have been removed. There's another surgery ahead. They're moving along, and it's only faith that's taking them through right now. So you looked around when we asked for those raised hands. So let's lift each other up in prayer today. Father, in the name of Jesus, God, we ask for that you would absolutely send a miracle, God, to that hospital room today that little Blaze Henderson is in. God, in the name of Jesus, that the power of the Holy Spirit would touch his body, would touch those lungs and open up those bronchial tubes. Lord, take what's wrong and make it right. God, touch Brother John today. Lord, raise him up that he would sing and praise and worship you once again, Lord, as you have anointed him to do so many times, God. In the name of Jesus, bring our prodigals home, Lord. Those who've left these altars, Lord, to go and live in this world without you, Lord. Bring them back. Turn them around. Get a hold of their hearts today, God. Touch the Springer family, Lord. Touch Brother Bernie, Lord. Give them peace, Lord, in the name of Jesus. God, minister to the Seifert family, Lord, God, as they walk through, Lord, this time of illness, God, in the name of Jesus. Lord, we love you today, God. We trust you. God, bring forth your word, Lord, from the preacher today in Jesus' name, and anoint us, God, to hear it. Thank you.
Amen. How are y'all doing this morning? Beautiful, beautiful rendition there. And we're getting into that time of the year, aren't we? Pam was putting up the decorations last night, and I just reached stuff that was too high to reach. Other than that, I didn't have a lot to do with it. But you know, when I look out this morning, you know, Pastor always compliments you. We got a good-looking congregation. Now, he's telling you the truth, by the way. You believe that. But you know, more than just looking good on the outside, how many know God's done a beautiful work? If you've been saved, God has done a beautiful work on the inside of you, hadn't he? In fact, God is beautiful, isn't he? He's the source of real beauty. And we're not just talking about physical beauty, but we're talking about spiritual beauty. You know, I want to talk to you today on a topic, and I found this, just a little background on this message, a little bit different how I got it. I was just reading, not incredibly different. I think you need to read the Bible to get a message. But just the way it happened, Pam and I went to Fort Benning for Thanksgiving. Before Thanksgiving, we camped out at around Fort Benning, and I was just getting away and just spending time with the Lord, just trying to be in his word and asking God, give me something new and fresh. And I read a lot, but then I got to Ezekiel chapter 16, which is where I'm going to be today, Ezekiel chapter 16, and it just came alive to me. And I've just never seen this like I did. And today I want to talk to you about a message entitled, Remember the Source of Your Beauty. Remember the Source of Your Beauty. And the idea of this message today is that we are made beautiful because of God's covenant of grace. God made us beautiful, didn't he? God is beautiful, and he is the source of the beautiful work that he's done in the lives of every believer. And we must be careful. As with Jerusalem, we must be careful to focus on the source of our beauty and not simply upon our God-given beauty. And so I want to give you a little background on Jerusalem. You know, Jerusalem's been entitled the city of David, the city of the great king, God's city. But Jerusalem hasn't always been that great. Jerusalem was founded by the Amorites and the Hittites. It was not a place, it was not in a good location. Jerusalem, the city of Jerusalem, was hard to defend. It was not in a real established trade route. And just about as quick as they founded the city of Jerusalem, they abandoned the city. They found no value in the city of Jerusalem, is what I'm getting at. It was abandoned. Anybody feel like you've ever been abandoned? Aren't you glad that God saw value in you? The Lord saw value in Jerusalem. Because it was under the Jebusites that David is going to take the city of Jerusalem. And under Solomon, it'll be in his most glorious state. And you remember even the Queen of Sheba, she came all the way and she said, do you know what she said of Jerusalem? The half has not even been told of just how beautiful it was. But I want to tell you that Jerusalem didn't start that beautiful. It started as a city that wasn't in a good spot. It started as a city that was hard to defend. And as just nearly as quick as they founded the city of Jerusalem in its infant state, they cast it out. But God had compassion on Jerusalem. God had compassion on you this morning. And I want to talk to you entitled Remember the Source of Your Beauty. Let's look in Ezekiel chapter 6, verses 4 through 14. Just for the sake of time, there's so much more I could read, but Ezekiel chapter 16, verses 4 through 14. And as you're getting there, hope y'all had a wonderful Thanksgiving as we look forward to this Christmas season. Y'all ready? All right. Chapter 16, verse 4. And as for thy nativity, speaking of Jerusalem, the city of Jerusalem, in the day that you were born, your navel was not cut, neither was you washed in water to supple thee. Thou was not salted at all, nor swaddled at all. None I pitied thee to do any of these things, to have compassion upon thee. But thou was cast out in the open field to the loathing of thy person in the day that thou wast born. And when I passed by thee and saw thee polluted in thine own blood, I said unto thee, when thou wast in thy blood, live. Yea, I said unto thee, when thou wast in thy blood, live. And I have caused thee to multiply as the bud of the field, and thou hast increased and waxen great. And thou art come to excellent ornaments. Thy breasts are fashioned, and thine hair is grown, whereas thou wast naked and bare. Now when I passed by thee, I looked upon thee, and behold, thy time was the time of love. And I spread my skirt over thee, and covered thy nakedness. Yea, I swear unto thee, and ye entered into a covenant with thee, said the Lord God, and thou became mine. Then I washed you with water. Yea, I thoroughly washed away the blood from you, and I anointed you with oil. I clothed thee also with embroidered work, and shod thee with badger's skin, and I girded you about with fine linen, and I covered you with silk. I decked you also with ornaments, and I put bracelets upon thine hands, and a chain on your neck, and I put a jewel on your forehead, and earrings in your ears, and a beautiful crown upon your head. Thus you were decked with gold and silver, and the raiment was of fine linen and silk and broidered work. You did eat fine flour and honey and oil, and thou wast exceeding beautiful. And you did prosper into a kingdom, and your renown went forth among the heathen for your beauty. For it was perfect through my comeliness. And I had put upon thee, saith the Lord. God bless you as you're seated. I want to pray real quick before I get right into these words. Y'all pray with me. Heavenly Father, in Jesus' precious name, Lord, we come to you today, Lord. We thank you for the beautiful work that you've done in our lives. We thank you for the beautiful work that you've done in this body of believers. But Lord, today I'm asking you to turn our eyes clearly back to the one who made that beauty possible. Lord, it's through your beauty that we can become beautiful, Father. And Lord, the work of your hands are beautiful. So Father, today I'm asking you, Lord, to help me to speak this word, God, with unction, anointing, that God, I may clearly convey what you want to be said. And we give you the glory and honor, Lord, in Jesus' name, amen, amen. We must remember the source of our beauty because the world left us naked, orphaned, and dying. Ezekiel 16:4 gives that description. When you look at the state of Jerusalem as a city, Ezekiel's going to liken it to an infant girl. Of course, Jerusalem has been likened, even in the book of Revelation. The new Jerusalem is likened to a bride. Oftentimes when the Lord talks about Jerusalem, he speaks of it as a her, she. This is very typical in ancient times. This was in Canaan. The Jebusites were Canaanites, the Amorites and the Hittites. These were all Canaanite people who existed in the land of Canaan before God's people entered in. It was very common for them. What were they looking for in a child? Many of them were looking for a strong young boy, a warrior, a future warrior. Oftentimes you saw female babies would be cast away, just like the picture of Jerusalem here. You know, we just had a baby a year ago, a little over a year ago now, and the first thing they did is they took that baby and they wrapped him up, cut that cord, washed him, made sure he was nurtured and taken care of, because in the infant state, those are very critical moments in a person's life, and they knew it. And so when we're looking at the city of Jerusalem here, it is likened to an infant because in its earliest state, instead of being nurtured like it should have been, cared for like it should have been, it was cast away into a field, naked, bloody, and not taken care of. And many young daughters in Canaan land were left to die to the elements. And that's what you see here with Jerusalem, the picture of Jerusalem. She's like that young baby girl who has been left to the elements because those that founded her did not know her value, did not see her value, and therefore discarded her as any other area that no one wants to inhabit. And many of you this morning can remember a time when maybe no one saw the value in you. You felt abandoned. You felt naked. You felt left to the elements of this world. And nobody, and it seemed like many people walked by you in that state and had no compassion on you. Just like the city of Jerusalem. But thank God, just like he walked by Jerusalem with compassion, he has walked by us with compassion. He has saw something in you, and I don't mean you in the sense of we're, you know, Paul said, in me dwells no good thing. What did God see the value in? Not in the sinfulness of my character, but in the value of the human soul, the eternal nature, the soul of man that he loves so dearly. God passed by that in compassion. And we find that God is a God of compassion. But as with Jerusalem, we were desolate, naked, filthy, orphaned, and we were dying in our sins, were we not? I would like to share a few verses that illustrate this. In regards to nakedness, the Lord says in Revelation 3:18, I advise you to buy for me gold refined in the fire that you may become rich, white raiment that you may clothe yourself, and the shame of your nakedness be not revealed. Now that's a spiritual nakedness. Jeremiah 2:22 says, although you wash yourself with lye and use much soap, in regards to filthiness, he says, the stain of your iniquity is before me, declares the Lord. And concerning being an orphan, listen to what Hosea writes. The Lord has compassion on the fatherless. Listen to what he says. For in you the fatherless find compassion. Of course, I could go on and on, but the point is, every one of us, now thank God when I was born into this world, my mom and my dad cared for me. They took me and they wrapped me, they fed me, they gave me a warm place to sleep, they loved me, and they cared for my basic human needs. But the reality is, spiritually, all of us are born into this world. I was praying over the 51st Psalm this morning, as I commonly do before I preach. And David said, behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. What was he saying? I was born into a condition that wasn't right with God. And so even though our families may have cared for us as infants, we were still born spiritually into this world, naked, dirty, orphans. And so this morning, through an excessive needs met, it's hard sometimes to see our real need. Most of my life, I've had every need met. Either I've been able to meet it, or my family was able to meet it, but there was a greater need besides clothes and food and shelter. There was a spiritual need. You see, that's the reason you and I have to be cognizant of what we need. Many in here, you say, Brother Chris, my life has never looked like this. I grew up in a loving home. I've had all my needs met. But you remember what Jesus told the Laodiceans again in verse 17, Revelation 3:17. He says, because you say I am rich and increase with goods and have no need of nothing, and you don't know that you are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. We were all this, weren't we? I'm not trying to cut you down. You need to know it. In order to not be these things, you need to know that spiritually you came into this world poor, miserable, blind, wretched. This is what salvation has come to correct. We can apply these principles to our lives when we actively seek to recognize our need. I, like you, forget my need sometimes for God. How can I apply this to my life? How can you apply this to your life? By daily asking the Lord to show you your need for him. And of course, being thankful for what he's done. But ask God to show you areas of your life that are lacking. And do not assume that because God has done so much that there's nothing else left to accomplish. If you have been saved, you are not miserable, poor, blind, and naked. But you absolutely are not a finished product yet either. And so ask the Lord to show you these areas of your life where there's still things he's wanting to do. It's really easy, though, to get to a point where you feel like, you know, there's this point of arrival, but we're not there yet. And so continually, daily, y'all seek the Lord and ask him, God, show me the needs that still exist in my heart and help me, Lord, to be willing to let you change me and meet those needs. We must remember the source of our beauty because, number two, God has passed by us in compassion. Aren't y'all grateful that we serve a compassionate God? Oh, my folks, we serve a God that doesn't just feel things for you. He's willing to do things for you. And where does this word compassion come from? All right, it comes from the 14th century. And it comes from the Latin that means calm and patty, which means to bear and suffer. That's where that word compassion comes from, according to Webster. And it implies pity coupled with a desire to aid and spare. For God so loved the world. That was the feeling, wasn't it? That he gave. That's compassion. It was his feeling that drove him to act. And thank God we serve a God that feels good things towards us, but he's willing to do good things for us too. We serve that God. Now, God's response to man's condition is compassion. You look in the garden. When Adam and Eve sinned, Adam fled from the presence of God. Why? Because I was afraid. What was he afraid of? He was afraid of God's response. He knew God is a God that doesn't lie, and God promised you'll die. But what did Adam and Eve truly receive? They received a covering, didn't they, from God? They didn't receive just a lightning bolt out of heaven to destroy them. They did die spiritually. And yes, humanity fell into a vicious condition of sin. But you still see God's compassion in that as well. As he killed an animal and clothed them. You know, they made fig leaves for themselves. And aren't we like Adam and Eve? We'll fix our problem, won't we? But God said the fig leaves aren't, that's not going to fix you. But God in his compassion, he illustrated for us in the garden what he was planning to do on Calvary when Jesus would die for our sins and cover us in his righteousness. God's response to Jerusalem is God's response to all people. He sees a great need and he's moved with compassion. He is moved with compassion. D.L. Moody said this. He told a story of his conversion. And you know, the most compassionate thing you and I can do is share the gospel with people. The most compassionate thing you can do is tell people the truth. Sometimes it seems like the most unloving, but it's the most loving thing you can do is tell people truth. D.L. Moody said this, and I quote, "When I was in Boston, I used to attend Sunday school class. And then one day I recollect my teacher came around behind the counter of the shop I was at work in, and he said, he put his hand upon my shoulder and talked to me about Christ and my soul. I had not felt that I had a soul till then. I said to myself, this is a very strange thing. Here is a man who never saw me till lately, and he is weeping over my sin, and I've never shed a tear about them. But I understand now and know what it is to have passion for men's souls and weep over their sins. I don't remember what he said, but I can still feel the power of that man's hand on my shoulder tonight. My question to you is, can you remember God's great compassion for you? Have you allowed God to be compassionate to you? He is a God of compassion, but he wants to be a God of compassion to you. Have you experienced his compassion? D.L. Moody had never experienced God's compassion until the night that that brother shared the gospel with him. And he said, though I can't remember everything he said, I can remember how it made me feel. And I'm going to tell you all, the night I gave my heart to Jesus, I was desolate, naked, dirty, orphaned, and dying. I can't remember everything that went on, but I can remember how he made me feel. I experienced God's compassion. You and I must have an experience with this compassion. You see, not only should we seek to recall the compassion that God has had on you, but I want to challenge you to share his compassion with others. An old Chinese proverb said this, "A bit of fragrance always clings to the hand that gives roses." And I want to encourage y'all this morning, be compassionate to people. Be compassionate. If you have experienced the compassion of God, be compassionate to others. How true is this? How true is this? For we never touch life of another without being touched ourselves, do we? How many of y'all have ever been compassionate to someone and it wasn't a direct blessing back to you? I'm not saying you got back more money than you gave. I'm saying spiritually God blessed your heart for that act of compassion. And it doesn't have to involve money. One way to remember God's compassion for you is by continually extending that compassion to others. Amen. Keep that passion, that compassion flowing. Why do we need to remember the source of our beauty? Because God is the one who declared life over you. If you look in verse 6 and 7, you'll see where the Lord saw us in our blood. He saw Jerusalem in her blood, and he said what? He said, live, live. What does that mean? He saw Jerusalem in her death, in her filth, in her desolation, and he declared life over her, and she lived. Ephesians 2, verses 4 through 5 states this, but God, who is rich in mercy. Somebody say rich in mercy. That sounds good, doesn't it? That's a God you serve who is rich in mercy. For his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were what? Dead in sins. He has quickened, that means made alive. He has quickened us together with Christ. For by grace you are saved. Before this quickening, we were all like Ezekiel's description of Jerusalem. We were dirty. We were desolate. We were dying. And we were orphaned. We were alienated from the life of God. This morning, I believe that God is speaking to some people. And he is wanting to say to your heart and to your spirit, live. Live. You think it's dead? I believe God is saying live. This is the spiritual state of every human being. Romans 5:12 says, wherefore, as by one man sin entered the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for all have sinned. We are spiritually dead because we were born into Adam. We are spiritually dead because we sin. You see, we are dead by birth, and we were dead by choice. But the Lord says, in that state of death, he gives us a way to live, doesn't he? He gives us a way to live. Through the lineage of Adam, which all people share, we are born spiritually dead and alienated from this life of God. It is only through second birth that you will have a new life and be made alive in God. We're talking about regeneration. The Holman Bible defines regeneration as the radical spiritual change in which God brings an individual from a condition of spiritual defeat and death to a renewed condition of holiness and life. This biblical doctrine of regeneration emphasizes God's role in making this spiritual change possible. You have to be born again. You're born the first time into death, into bondage of sin. And you're born into Adam. That's why Jesus took Adam to the cross, so that sin could be condemned in Adam. In the last Adam, the power of sin is broken. The only way the power of sin is broken in your life is if you are placed into his work. You have to be born again. I'm so thankful for my son. I love him to death. But my prayer for him is that one day he'll be born again. That as he receives spiritual life, November 17th, 2021, physical life, one day he will receive eternal life. Because I know that's the most important birth that he can experience. I want to see my son love God, and I want to see my son in eternal life. You know, Brother Ed Bell always told me, he said, Chris, don't ever walk up and slap a blind man because he can't see. What was he saying? It's not his fault. I'm not making light of people who are blind. He was talking about spiritual blindness too. He said, you can't be mad at a blind man because he can't see. But you can be mad at a man who can see for acting blind. That's what he told me. I want to give you a quick illustration here from a book. In his book, An Anthropologist on Mars, neurologist Oliver Sacks tells about Virgil, a man who had been born blind from early childhood. When he was 50, Virgil underwent surgery and was given the gift of sight. But as he and Dr. Sacks found, having physical capacity for sight is not the same as seeing. Virgil's first experience with sight were confusing. He was able to make out colors and movements, but arranging them into coherent pictures was more difficult. Over time, he learned to identify various objects, but his habits, his behaviors, were still those of a blind man. Dr. Sacks asserts, one must die as a blind person to be born again as a seeing person. It is in the interim, the limbo, that is so terrible. To truly see Jesus and his truth means more than just observing what he did or what he said, doesn't it? We must have a change of identity. This man who had been blind all of his life, when he finally received the ability to see, he carried on living in habits of a blind man. And in order for him, he's no longer a blind man. He was able to receive his sight. Spiritually, you receive sight when you have been born again. Jesus told Nicodemus in John chapter 3:3, he said, verily, verily, I say unto you that except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. But if you've been born again, you can see the kingdom of God. And if you can see, then don't live as though you can't see. Because there's no longer any excuse for blindness. Live as people who have been given their spiritual eyes and learn to see through those eyes. Paul said we see through a glass darkly, but let's seek to see as clearly as we can through that glass. Are you born again? That's my question. When did God speak life into you? When did new life enter you? Y'all know I'm not talking about just simply changing your behavior. There's a lot that'll make you want to change your behavior. Not wanting to get in trouble will make you change your behavior. Some of y'all worked in law enforcement. You'll know going to jail or prison make you want to change your behavior, or at least act like it. But we're not taught salvation's not just change of behavior. It's not behavioral modification or reformation. But we're talking about a new life, not a better life. Not a more moral life in your old self, but a new life. God doesn't repair the old. He births the new. That's what he wants. So you and I must be born again. I see this a lot in ministry, especially on the chaplaincy side in the military. These guys come to me, and they'll tell me stuff, and I'm like, what faith are you? Like, I'm a Christian. I said, well, okay. Let's talk about that, because I don't always see the evidence of a new life being lived out. I'll just put it that way. But are you born again? We're not talking about behavior change, not even a change of location, but new life. Do you have new life this morning in you? Are you not, I quit smoking, drinking, being immoral, I quit being mean, but are you born again? Because a lot of that stuff will go away when you're born again, and you'll be free. So don't just, you know, Leonard Ravenhill said this, and he could be tough now. He was a tough old preacher, but he said this. He said, Jesus did not come into the world to make bad men good. He came into the world to make dead men live. That's what the gospel is intended to do. Not make you just act better, but make you spiritually alive. So are you trying to be good, or have you been made alive when you were spiritually dead? An application of this is simply this. The Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians 13:5, Paul said, examine yourselves, whether you be in the faith. Prove your own selves. Know ye not your own selves, how that Christ is in you, except you be reprobates. What can you do? You know if Christ is in you. Examine yourself. Is there a living, vibrant, real relationship with your Creator, with your God? Is He Father to you? Is Jesus Savior to you? Not just Savior of the world, but Savior of your soul. That's what you have to be able to answer. You see, that's what God has come to do, y'all. Examine your hearts. That's how we apply this. Are you spiritually alive? Do you have a current living relationship with God? Do you desire the things of God? Are we just satisfied with the bare bones of religion? Or do I want more, more, more? I have to do this, y'all. Absolutely have to do this all the time. But we need to examine ourselves, because if we don't, guess what we're going to do? We're going to forget the source of our beauty. And we're going to begin trusting in our own beauty. We're going to begin. Listen, God brought me where I'm at. God gave me everything I have. God has given me every opportunity I have today. He's given me a beautiful wife and family and opportunities. But here's the problem with me, and I dare say the problem with us, is that if I don't continue to look to Him, I'm going to begin to boast in all the things I am and all the things I have. That was Jerusalem's problem, by the way. God made her beautiful, and she began to trust her own beauty. Or as we might say in 2022, or maybe in 1997, I don't know if they still say this today, but we begin to believe our own hype, right? God's the one that is the source of all of this. And so as we continue to draw closer to Him, we continue to realize that He is the source of beauty, because we must continue to look to Him as the source of beauty, because He is the one who washed us from our filthiness. We see all of this in Jerusalem. Proverbs 30:20 says this, that there is a generation that is pure in its own eyes, yet is not washed from its filth. When we begin to take our eyes off the one who washes us, we're going to begin that we are pure in ourselves, but yet we're not going to be washed. Isaiah 4:4 says, when the Lord shall have washed away the filth of the daughters of Zion, and shall have purged the blood of Jerusalem from the midst thereof by the spirit of judgment and by the spirit of burning. Now, that's talking about the end of the age. We don't want God to necessarily cleanse us through wrath and judgment, do we? But we certainly want God, through His merciful grace and presence, to cleanse our hearts. All right. Now, I simply use these verses to illustrate the fact that some are going to be cleansed and some do not receive cleansing due to being self-righteous. Oh, Brother Chris, I'm clean already. You don't know. I don't live like that. Got saved when I was 8. I've never been to a bar. I don't know what beer smells like. Okay? I'll leave it at that. There's a lot of reasons we need our heart cleansed, and it's not just because we've never smelled a beer, isn't it? Maybe because we've held hatred in our hearts, bitterness, unforgiveness, right? We couldn't control what we said about other people. And there's a lot of people got saved at 8, 10 years old that have dealt with these problems. What am I saying? We need God to help us, don't we? I'm not condemning nobody. We just need God to continue to cleanse our hearts. We all need that. If we come right off the street yesterday, or we've been in here most of our lives, we need God's continual cleansing, y'all. Gotta have it. Gotta have it. And He's the one that does that. What was David's prayer? He said, wash me. What was John the Baptist? What was he doing? He was putting people in water, wasn't he? And Jesus even told Peter, unless I wash you, you have no part with me. And a towel draped Jesus said that to Peter. Without our being washed clean by Christ, we'll die in our sins. There's a few kind of people in here today. And I love all of you. I'm just telling you what God told me. There are those in here today that have been cleansed, and you know it. There are those in here that think you're clean in yourself. There are those that recognize their need for God to cleanse them. And then there are those who feel too dirty to be cleansed. Look no further than Jesus' parable of the Pharisee and the publican, Luke 18:10-14. Jesus said this, speaking of a tax collector and a Pharisee. Two men went up into the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a publican. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus himself. He said, God, I thank you that I am not like these other men are. They're extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this publican. Let me stop there for just a moment. The worst thing you could have been called was a tax collector or a publican. because you were a Jew who was collecting taxes for Rome. And you know how you paid your salary? You collected more than was required and you kept the rest. You were a thief, in essence. And that's, so when this man said, he said, thankfully I'm not like an extortioner. I'm not like an unjust adulterer. And praise the Lord, I'm not a tax collector. That's what this Pharisee's really saying. He said, I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all that I possess. And the publican, standing afar off, would not lift so much of his eyes unto heaven, but he smote himself on the breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. And I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone that exalts himself shall be abased, and everyone that humbles himself shall be exalted. We can apply this principle to our lives by simply remaining humble and close to God. We must be like the publican in the sense that he understood where he really stood with God. You don't have to be a thieving tax collector, all right? But you can be like his heart. He understood in the presence of God that he was unworthy. You could be the most faithful giver. And y'all know I want to encourage your giving. Be a giver. Be a cheerful giver. You can be the most faithful attender. Please come to church. Please be here. You can be a Bible reader, a prayer. But if our standing with God rests in the things we are doing, we are on the wrong attitude altogether. We, while a cleansed heart, should produce many, if not all, of these wonderful things. These things by themselves do not produce a new heart that is only attainable by faith in God's word. What has God said of you? Do you believe what he said about you? And are you willing to let God make the change in you that he wants to make? That's what really changes us. We must remember the source of our beauty. Why? Because it is God who makes all things beautiful. God makes things beautiful, y'all. Amen. When I think about things being made beautiful, I think of Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 11. Y'all know this. And it states that he has made everything beautiful in his time. And he has also set the world, that means eternity, in the heart, so that no man can find out the work that God maketh from the beginning to the end. He creates beauty in his time. Some of you this morning, you have come to the Lord. You're struggling in certain areas of your life, and you think that it's just your life is ugly. I want to encourage you, if God has done a work in your life, it's beautiful. And I want you to cling to the process, because God is making all things beautiful in his time. I'm not saying all things in this world are beautiful, but how many of you know one day they will be? God's going to make the entire universe beautiful again in his time. But right now in your life, if the Lord has done a work in you, I think sometimes Satan tries to convince us that we're uglier now than we were before the Lord saved us. He does that because what he's trying to do is if he can't make you self-righteous to the point where you think, I'm above all that and I've arrived, then what he's going to do on the opposite end of that spectrum is he's going to make you think you can never arrive because you're too bad, too dirty. I got news for you this morning. You're not that bad this morning, that God can't do something in your life. Am I saying we're not bad? Listen, I've done bad things. I've been a sinner. And I've done things that I was raised not to do. But here's what I found out. When God put his life in me, that was beautiful. And what God wants to do is he wants to work that life out and grow that life. Why? So that we can radiate the beauty of his son. Not the beauty of our old life. There's nothing beautiful about what I was. But oh, thank God. Thank God there is something beautiful about who he is. And that's the beauty that he wants to cultivate in your life and in my life. And if the enemy can continue to keep us focusing on the ugliness of our old life, then we'll naturally take our eyes off of the beauty of the new life. And I believe God wants someone to hear that this morning. Maybe all of us to hear that. Let the Lord cultivate this beautiful life that he's put in you, because it is the life of his son, and his son is beautiful. You remember what he said of Jesus, "This is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased." God put the life. You're not Jesus. You're you. But he's put the life of his son in you to conform you to the image of his son. He's not making us Jesus, but praise God, he's making us like Jesus, isn't he? He's making us. We become partakers of his divine nature. We don't become divine. You're not God. I'm not God. Never will be. Don't need to be. But thank God we can take on his likeness and his beauty and his glory. And that's what God wants to do in you this morning. Last thing I want to say, it is safe to say that God does beautiful work. You don't have to look far to discover the beauty of God's creation. Likewise, you don't have to look far to see man's corrupting touch on his creation. But God makes things beautiful, and that includes his children. What God declares beautiful is not always what man does, but God's view of beauty is true beauty. Psalm 24:7 said, "One thing I have asked from the Lord, that I shall seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to meditate in his temple." God makes everything beautiful, and God is beautiful. Christians are being conformed to this beautiful image, physically, spiritually now, and one day physically will awaken his likeness. This beautiful work begins when one is birthed into the life of God. If you've been born again, you're as saved as you'll ever be. But you may not be as much like Jesus as you'll ever be. Don't confuse the two, right? Don't confuse those two things. Sam, I think, preached an awesome message on sanctification. Sanctification is a part of salvation. That's a part of being saved, continual working of God in your life. Sanctification works out the beauty of God in the life of a believer, the beauty of the image of his son in the life of a believer. Romans 8:29, part A of that verse says this, "For whom he did foreknow, he also predestinated to be conformed to the image of his son." Have I established this morning that the image of Jesus is beautiful? And if you're being conformed to that image, that's a beautiful image to be conformed to. What am I saying? There's a beautiful work going on in your life. The enemy wants to discount that every day. He wants to discredit that every day. He wants you to look at the image of you that's not beautiful. God wants you to look to the image of him that is beautiful. Behold Jesus, because that's the beautiful image that you and I are becoming like. Jesus is beautiful, and we're being conformed to that. We are becoming beautiful. As we have established, God is beautiful. And because he's conforming you and me to his likeness, we are becoming beautiful in the sense of the image of Jesus in our life. Some in here today are proud of where God has brought you, and some of you can only dream of where he will bring you. It is so easy. It's human nature to revert back to old ways of thinking. It's easy, as it was with the people of Jerusalem that Ezekiel mentioned, to begin to trust in the beauty that God has given. I'm not for one moment trying to discourage you and I from thinking about the great things that God has done for us, but do not begin to turn what God has done into a boast of your own worth and beauty. This is what Jerusalem did, and why did they do it? It is because they forgot their beauty came from God, and they forgot that without God, they would have died in the field naked, dirty, and desolate. And while we're encouraged to look, Paul said, "I press on." We are encouraged to look ahead, because he says, "I press on to the mark of the high calling." That was waking up in the image of Jesus, y'all. That was the high calling he was pressing towards. But I want to also encourage you that when you look at your life, never forget where he's brought you from, the person he's making you in him, and where he's taking you. Because they forgot, Jerusalem forgot that nobody wanted Jerusalem in the beginning. Nobody passed by Jerusalem and said, "Wow, that's a place I'd like to live. Wow, that's a place I'd like to do business. Or I'd like to fight to defend that city." Nobody said that about early Jerusalem. They were desolate. They were forgotten. But it was when God passed by them with pity and compassion that he made Jerusalem the great city, that the half of its beauty could only be told across the known world. Why? Because of God's work in Jerusalem. Under King Solomon, Jerusalem was as beautiful as it ever was. Under King David, it was as mighty as it ever was. But it forgot where that might and where that beauty came from. And they began to use their beauty to lure people in. They began to forget who made them beautiful and worship that which didn't. And you're going to see Jerusalem. I don't have to tell you the history of Jerusalem. If you study it, you'll see what happened to Jerusalem because they forgot the one who made them beautiful. And so the most important takeaway is if you're here today and you're a believer, you love Jesus, you're living for Jesus, here's the three biggest takeaways I want you to take with you. Don't forget the source of your beauty. Don't trust your beauty alone. And remember where you were before the Lord passed by you in pity and compassion. I want to open these altars up this morning. I feel like I've said a lot. I hope God has said a lot. But my question to you is, are you still without God this morning in here? You're at church. Glad you're here. We really are. We love you. We welcome you. But it's more than coming into a building, isn't it? It's coming into a new life in Christ. That's what we're interested in more than anything else. Are you still without God? Are you like Jerusalem was out there in that field, naked, desolate, dirty, dying? Secondly, you're here this morning, and you may be here without God. You may be here in a situation that you and only God know about. My question to you this morning is, can you feel God passing by you with compassion? We sang an old song and still do sometimes. He's passing by this moment, your needs to supply. Reach out and touch the Lord as he goes by. Can you feel the Lord, the compassionate Lord, passing by you this morning? You know the need. Is it salvation? Is it something else? Thirdly, do you need him to speak life over you today? So much death in this world, isn't there? So much depression and stress and angst in this world. But I mean, you know, one breath from God can bring about eternal change. One word. Do you need him to speak life over you today? Are you tired of feeling morally and spiritually filthy? Do you need him to wash you today? How many of y'all remember when you got saved? I remember just how dirty I felt. But I remember after God washed me, just how clean I felt. I've needed a lot of washing since then, folks. But I can just remember, oh, he washed me. He washed me. He says, and I may have perhaps even skipped over the verse that I meant to read. But the Lord washed us. And you know, that's the kind of washing that Dial soap can't perform, isn't it? You can get that body clean and pretty and get everything looking nice on the outside, but there's still a stain of filth on the inside. That's sin, isn't it? But God can take the blood of Jesus and he can wash our hearts, can't he? He can cleanse our soul. And what Dial soap can't make clean, the blood of Jesus can make clean. The Word of God can make clean. And so lastly, I want to ask you this morning, have you forgotten the one that made you beautiful? Have you begun to trust in your own beauty? Well, I'm glad I'm not like they are. Thank God I'm not like that. Well, thank God I'm not like a lot of things, but I just don't want to forget who made me this way. Is that you this morning? You say, Brother Chris, if I could just get every eye closed, maybe every head bowed for just a moment and just be real direct with you. You say, I'm here, Brother Chris, and I need to get my life right with God. I don't need you to explain it. I know what I need to do. If that's you this morning, on the count of three, I just want you to slip that hand up, slip it right back down. I'll see it. God will see it. One, two, three. Hands going up all over this sanctuary. Here's what I want. Hey, he's a God of compassion, folks. Oh, he's a God of compassion. But here's what we find about the Lord. His compassion, his feeling caused him to move. For For God so loved the world that he would become a man and he would change location. He'd come down to this earth and he'd die for your sin and my sin. And he'd wash the filth of that from our hearts and our lives and off our record in heaven. If you're here this morning, just as God came for you, I want to encourage you to make a move this morning. These altars are open. There are brothers and sisters who will pray with you. If you raise your hand to receive the Lord, to get your heart right with God, I want to encourage you to come. If that's you, come in the name of Jesus. He loves you. Oh, God loves you this morning. Come. There's people coming. If you're here this morning and any of these other things you feel, Chris, it applies to me. Brother Chris, something you said that you didn't even say it, but I felt God said it to me. And I feel like it applies to me. Come, I want to encourage you, come down to this altar. And let's be reminded this morning who made us beautiful. There's someone being made beautiful this morning. His heart's being made right with God this morning. And it's a beautiful work. So I want to encourage you, if that's you this morning, come. If you raise your hand and you're not down here, I want to encourage you to talk to somebody today. Let them know your need, your God-felt need this morning to be saved. Y'all, these altars are open. You feel free to come worship the Lord. Come seek the Lord as this worship group is singing. God bless you.
Love.
This morning, God's still passing by some people wanting to be compassionate. I feel that's what the Lord told me. I don't drag things out, but if God's dealing with your heart, this is the time of love, he told Jerusalem. He's looking on you in the time of love and a time of compassion. If that's you this morning, please respond to God's promptings. Respond appropriately how you know you need to. Let God do what you and I know he can do. If you're down here, and I feel faith really strong up here today. If you need anything, if you need prayer, if you need any special prayer, I believe God, he's always doing things, but I believe today is a day that you can see prayer is met, needs met. So I want to encourage you to come if that's you. That's you this morning. Come, let us pray for you. God has time for you. The Lord had time for Jerusalem. He made her a beautiful city. Made her a beautiful city. Did a beautiful work. And I want to believe this morning he wants to do a beautiful work in this house. And you feel free to stay. God bless you. You feel free to leave. But we just want to believe God this morning. Y'all believe God with us. Amen.